Yeah, welcome to the really definitely last lecture of this semester, and I promise it won't be more than 20 minutes. It's only a little bit left. Huh? But maybe, yeah, let's start with repetition of what we did last time. And I mean, this really was important because these methods for solving overdetermined and underdetermined linear systems are so important for applied mathematics because there are so many applications for them. I mean, you learn in linear algebra that there only is a unique solution for a linear system if the matrix is a square matrix first, and second, if this matrix is invertible. Yeah? And what we saw now are two methods for solving such a system, even if the matrix is not square. Yeah? And if it's a non-square matrix, then there is no chance to invert the matrix. There is no matrix which is not square that can be inverted. No? And if it can't be inverted, then there is no solution. No? I mean, in the underdetermined case, then we do have typically, normally we have infinitely many solutions, but there is no unique solution. So in the underdetermined case, we have infinitely many solutions normally. In the overdetermined case, we normally have no solution. And now we found two methods we found variants of one method, which is the pseudo-inverse method, to solve over and underdetermined systems. But now, what does that mean, solve such systems? I just told you they are not solvable. What is the answer? What does solve an overdetermined and underdetermined system mean?
We find the closest solution that's possible.
Yes, yes. We find a closest approximation to a solution that is possible. And I mean, that's what we learned last time. So, let's go back to the overdetermined system. What did we do? I mean, this is the linear system. Here we have an example, which is overdetermined. So there is no such solution x such that this system of equations can be satisfied. So now what we do is we bring the y to the left-hand side and look at this difference, and now we require the Euclidean norm of the difference to be as small as possible. I mean, that's the best we can achieve. Yeah, and then we solved the whole thing, and finally we saw that, here we have it, the pseudo-inverse method gives us such an approximate solution. And this is the formula for the pseudo-inverse here. So we need to compute M transpose M, then invert this and multiply with M transpose. Okay. And here in the example you see it's easy to apply. I mean, you just take this matrix M here, multiply it with the transpose, and then that's what we have, and solve this linear system. Okay, now in the underdetermined case, it doesn't make sense to talk about approximate solutions, because there are infinitely many exact solutions. So now we have kind of the opposite problem. The question is, which one out of these infinitely many solutions is the solution that kind of solves the problem best? Yeah? Maybe I again show such an example. For example, if we are given 2 points and we are looking for a function approximating these 2 data points. And now if the function class that we allow would be the class of straight lines, then we would get a unique solution. Because in this class we have 2 parameters which are 2 unknowns, and we get 2 equations from the 2 points, so then there is a unique solution. But if we, for example, talk about polynomials of order 2, which are parabolas, then there are infinitely many solutions. And which one out of these infinitely many solutions is now the best? That's a good question. And the idea behind the approach is to take a simple solution. A simple solution. And simple solution means we want our parameters, these coefficients. I mean, here we are talking about f of x is equal to a1 plus a2x plus a3x squared. A simple solution is one where these coefficients have small values. For example, this is such a simple solution because here this coefficient is exactly 0. So this coefficient has the smallest possible value. This is 0, and these 2 are non-zero. And then we get such a solution. But we could also require all coefficients to be as small as possible. So you see there are many possibilities, many different possibilities. What we chose here was we want the Euclidean norm of the solution vector to be as small as possible. And this is kind of have all the parameters small. That's what we want. So now we minimize the Euclidean norm under the constraint, which is this equation. This is a vector equation, which then is many scalar equations. So each one of these equations is, in terms of the Lagrangian method, one constraint. So if we have n equations here, then this gives us a minimization problem. Minimize the square norm of this vector x under these n constraints. And if you look at this here, this is the part of the Lagrangian function with the constraints. This vector lambda has length n, lambda 1 through lambda n, and one such lambda for each one of these equations. For each constraint, you get one of these Lagrangian parameters. Okay, so this is the Lagrangian function. And then the gradient of the Lagrangian has to be equal to 0. And I mean, we solved the whole thing and we got such a pseudo inverse again. This is quite similar, just that before we had to calculate M transpose M, and now we take M M transpose. Invert it and multiply from left with M transpose. Yeah. I also mentioned last time, of course, this is I mean, at least for you who see this for the first time, this may be kind of arbitrary to use the Euclidean norm here. And it is possible to use a different norm. For example, the one norm. Where you don't take the squares of all the values, you just take the absolute values and the sum of them. And this is possible, and this would lead to a solution where individual parameters may be exactly zero. Okay. Yeah. And now we look at an example. We look at an example of polynomial interpolation, where we now compare these three cases, overdetermined, exact solution, and underdetermined. Look, this is our function class. We are looking at the class of polynomials of degree 6. So we have 7 coefficients. And I mean, you know from the polynomial interpolation, which was the very first basic start. We take this ansatz, and now we substitute all the points in this formula here. And how many points do we have? 2, 4, 5 points. So we get 5 equations. For each point, we get 1 equation. If we take the first point, 1, 1, then we have a1 plus a2 plus a3 and so on. So you see all the coefficients are 1. And that's what we get as a first equation. Times the vector a is equal to 1. The second equation, we have x equal 2. So we get 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. This 64 is 2 to the power 6 here. And then next x is 3. That's what we get, and so on. How is this matrix called?
Van der Monde matrix.
Yes, thank you. That's the Van der Monde matrix. It's only almost the Van der Monde matrix. What is missing to the Van der Monde matrix? Look, this is a matrix with 7 columns and 5 rows. What was the size of the Van der Monde matrix? Yes, and this is not a square matrix. So in order to get the Van der Monde matrix, we would need 2 more rows. Of course, we would need 7 points to determine 7 parameters. But now we have this nice method for solving underdetermined systems, and that's what we do. Okay, now I mean we solve this linear system. Here this is underdetermined. So we take exactly this formula here. And that's what we get. Look here. So k is equal to 7. That's the number of parameters. And the number of points is 5. And here you have the vector of the coefficients. And that's how it looks like. I mean, the blue dots, of course, are the points, and that's the solution. And that looks nice, doesn't it? Especially here, we don't have any oscillations here between these points. I mean, here the function is supposed to be more or less constant. And the result is quite nice. Now let's look at this image here. I mean, here I reduced k to 5, which means our polynomial ends here, right here. So it's only a polynomial of degree 4. We determine with our given 5 points a polynomial of degree 4. And here we get a unique solution. These are the coefficients. And now you see this doesn't look as nice as this one. And so please try to remember our discussion about polynomial interpolation. And in the light of this, this is kind of surprising because here with the lower degree polynomial, we get bigger oscillations than here with the higher degree polynomial. Isn't that surprising? I mean, the same points here and there. Here the degree of the polynomial is higher, but the oscillations are smaller. What's the reason for this? I mean, here we can't really ask for a reason because this is polynomial interpolation. Given our points, we determine the unique polynomial. But here, what does our pseudo-inverse method do to determine these 7 coefficients? What we do here is we minimize the norm of our coefficient vector. Okay? So we try to find out of this infinite set of coefficients. Remember, here we have infinitely many solutions. There are infinitely many polynomials of degree, what was the degree? 6. Of degree 6 through these 5 points. Infinitely many solutions. And out of these infinitely many solutions, we select one which has small coefficients. And small coefficients, of course, means that these oscillations are not too high. And now look at this coefficient. This is the coefficient for the sixth order term, for the x power 6 term. And this coefficient is quite small. And that's the reason why these oscillations are not too high. I mean, we do have a little bit, a very little bit of oscillation here. So you see, it. This is a really powerful tool, this pseudo-inverse method, because even with polynomials of high degree, we can get quite nice and smooth approximations. But of course, I mean, we have to be careful. This is not always true. I mean, there are examples, and we will see one, where the result is not so nice. Okay, but now let's look here at the overdetermined case. We have the same points. 5 points, and now we reduce k to 3, which means we approximate a parabola, and that's the solution we get. Yeah. Okay, yes. But now let's look at these two again. I mean, in these two cases, these two cases are quite different from this one, because here we cannot hit all the points. So this is the case where we have many points and looking for a low degree polynomial. This only makes sense if we can assume that there is some noise on the points and we really want to kind of interpolate between the points our curve. But here in these two cases, we hit all the points. And now, remember what we have seen when we did polynomial interpolation. We had this example, which was this one. We had this, the dashed line is our original curve, such a bell-shaped curve. And then we determined a polynomial. We took 11 points equidistant, and then the result was really bad. In the equidistant case, we had really bad oscillations. And then we looked at the Chebyshev interpolation, where we have a formula that tells us how to distribute our points, and then we got this result. Okay, and here we got 11 given points, and there we can uniquely determine a polynomial of degree 10. And that's what we got. And now I thought, from this experience, here we have the higher degree polynomial and use the pseudo-inverse method. Maybe that would help here too. So we increase the degree of the polynomial, and then because we increase the degree of the polynomial, we get infinitely many solutions, and the pseudo-inverse method selects us one with small parameters. And this is the result. So this is not an improvement. It's actually even worse. Look here, this oscillation doesn't go into the negative, but here it does. So it's even a little bit worse. Yeah. So still, whenever you use such parametric methods, these methods, they are called parametric methods because we determine parameters. Given our data, we determine parameters. And when you determine such parameters, then the method is not fully automatic. In the sense, look, you have to select these basis functions. And that's crucial, that's very important. If I select powers of x as basis functions, then I get a polynomial. But maybe for some application it would be better as basis functions to use trigonometric functions or whatever. So you really, I already mentioned, whenever you have some knowledge about these basis functions, please apply this knowledge. Do not expect this mathematics to be really intelligent. Yeah, and that's actually the point where we now could step or go into AI, where we want to have really universal, intelligent function approximators, and where we do not want the user to specify such a set of basis functions. Huh? But this is not the topic of this lecture. Okay, yeah, here you see these results and this result, and I already mentioned that in the underdetermined case, we used the square of the Euclidean norm, which we minimized. But there are many other possibilities of functions to be minimized. I mentioned you could use the one norm. Sometimes this is also called L1. L1 norm. because this comes from in functional analysis, this is a space of functions where we use then the L1 norm, and this one is the L2 norm, and there is the L infinity norm, the L3 norm, and so on. So you could use all these norms to be minimized, and you would get different results. Another selection would be to use the entropy function to be minimized, and those students who attend the AI lecture, you know this entropy minimization technique. The entropy is being maximized. Huh? This is a maximum entropy technique, which is used in probabilistic reasoning and which can be actually proven as being giving the optimal solutions. Huh? And this entropy function actually is not too far from the two norm. Yeah? The two norm is nothing but sum over I equal 1 to n xi squared. Huh? That's the two norm of a vector. And now let's take the entropy h of a vector x. This is the sum over, no, sorry, it's minus the sum. Minus the sum I equal 1 to n xi times ln xi. First difference is the minus here. And that's why we have to maximize the entropy when we minimize this. Yeah? So if we omit the minus, then we would minimize this sum. And now this sum is quite similar. Look, we can write this as sum over I xi times xi. So now here you have this xi, and this second xi is replaced by the logarithm. So this is quite similar, and you would get quite similar results. Oh yeah, die Wurzel fehlt, also machen wir da ein Quadrat hin. Okay? Thank you. But it doesn't matter. We already talked about this. If you omit a square root and maximize the whole thing, it wouldn't change. The maximum would be the same. But of course, this equality was not correct. Okay, yeah. Let's talk a little bit about the computing time for the pseudo-inverse method. Yeah? And this, if you have a large number of data points, this may be quite costly. I mean, the most expensive part of the computation is this here. So compute m times m transpose and invert this. Yeah? The matrix M is, let's see here, it's N times K matrix. Yeah. So computing this product M times M transpose costs us k squared times n effort. Look, this is the matrix times the transpose. And what you get as a result here is a square matrix. This is a square matrix k by k. And here we have k columns and n rows. K rows, n columns. So the effort to calculate this square matrix with k squared elements, of course you have a factor k squared, because you have to calculate each one of these elements. And what is the effort for calculating one such element? So in order to calculate some element here, you have to multiply this row by this column. And the length of this row is n, and the length of this column is n too. So the effort here is linear in n. So we get n times k squared as the effort for calculating this matrix. And that's what we have here, k squared times n. And now when we are finished, when we do have this square matrix, this k by k square matrix, then you have to invert this, and this goes with the Gaussian algorithm, and you know that this complexity is n cubed. So we get k squared n plus k cubed. So now what you see is that what really matters is not so much the number of data points. What's more important is the number of coefficients in your function to be approximated. And this typically is not extremely large. I mean, you may have 10 coefficients. You may even, in some extreme case, have 100 coefficients, but normally not. But even if you have 100 coefficients, this is possible. What is not so critical in this formula is n, because it's only linear in n. So you may have 1 million data points, and this still is possible. Okay, yes, and now we are actually finished. Let me mention one more method, but this does not come this semester. We will do this next semester, which is the SVD, which is the next chapter here. Singular value decomposition. And this singular value decomposition, look, I mean, we started today talking about the case of a unique solution where we have a linear system of the type m times vector x is equal to vector y, where this m is a square matrix. Here we get a unique solution. But it may be the case that m is not square. Then we have no solution or infinitely many solutions. We use the pseudo-inverse and find an approximate solution. So even if this matrix is not square, then we can apply the pseudo-inverse method. Okay, fine. But now, this pseudo-inverse method, it may look like, no matter how this matrix M looks like, we can always apply the pseudo-inverse solution. But this is not true. Look here. Can this be computed always? For all arbitrary matrices M? No, no, no. M doesn't need to be square. No.
The result.
If M times M transpose is invertible, then
yes. So this only works if M transpose is invertible. I mean, that's trivial. So you cannot apply this all the time. So be careful. I mean, implement it in Octave or in MATLAB or Mathematica and apply it to arbitrary matrices, and you will soon see there are cases where you get an answer, no solution, because MM transpose is not invertible. So this cannot be applied always. And that's really, I mean, that's not nice, because there are overdetermined systems for which you can do not get an approximate solution with the pseudo-inverse method. There are underdetermined systems where also you don't get a solution. And that's not nice. But there is a method which is actually quite young. It was developed, I guess, not more than 20 years ago, maybe even closer, which is the singular value decomposition method. And this method, I mean, for the case where M transpose, or in the other case, M transpose M, when this matrix is invertible, then the pseudo-inverse method gives you the same solution. Then the SVD method gives you the same solution as the pseudo-inverse. But if this is not invertible, then with the SVD method, you still get a solution. So that's a really important and powerful kind of generalization of the pseudo-inverse method. And we will start with this in the beginning of next semester. Okay, and oh yeah, and here I missed one slide, but this is really short. The formula for the pseudo-inverses we had here, which is this one, for example, in the underdetermined case, that's a so-called Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. There are actually different definitions of pseudo-inverses. This is one pseudo-inverse, and there are other ones. And this is the so-called Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. And for a Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse, these equations must hold. Look, so we call M plus is the pseudo-inverse. So then M plus in our underdetermined case would be M transpose times M transpose inverse. This is the Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. And such a Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse has to fulfill these two equations. M plus times M is equal to M. Does this make sense? Yes, it does. Let's talk about an inverse of a matrix. What is an inverse matrix? M inverse times M is equal to the identity matrix, I. That's the property of an inverse matrix. Okay? Of course, a pseudo-inverse does not fulfill this equation. Because there is no inverse, otherwise it would be an inverse. So we cannot require the pseudo-inverse to fulfill such an equation. But maybe something simpler. Now, let's multiply this equation with M from left. Then we get M times M inverse times M is equal to M. Okay? And now compare this equation with the first equation on the slide. So you see, this is the property that a Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse has to fulfill, the first property. And the second property, we get it if we take this equation and multiply it with M inverse from the right. Now, if you compare, this is this equation multiplied with M inverse from the right. That's what we get then. If you compare this with the second equation over there, then you see this is the second property that a Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse has to fulfill. Yeah. And yeah, let's look again at these equations. If you look at this product here, We have to look over there because these are the inverses. Look at this product, m times the pseudo inverse. So the product of m times its pseudo inverse, I mean, that's something that behaves like the unity matrix, like the identity. Yeah? So, yeah, let me ask. Now, is it now true that m times m plus is equal to the identity? Is this true? Can you derive this from that over there? I would rather say no. I mean, you might say yes if, but only if you multiply it with m. So applied to m, this guy behaves like the identity, but only if you apply it to m. If you apply it to some other matrix, this does not behave like the identity. Yeah, and I mean here, you... yeah, you can, for example, this also behaves like the identity if you apply it from the right to m plus. Okay, yeah, so that's it. Thank you.